So in today's lecture, we are going to start with the multicolored partitions, necklaces, how one can partition the necklaces and so that the precious gems that are available in the necklaces can be equally partitioned. And we'll also see the Kinzer's conjecture and its proof. But before we start this lecture today, I just want to mention that in the previous lecture, I left this exercise, the general position version for this ham sandwich theorem, and I have made a mistake where I said that the hyperspace should contain at most floor of half the AI points. It should be exactly these many points. Otherwise, this is same as the previous version, right? So it's exactly. So this is a stronger version of the one which we did in the previous lecture. So today, let's start with the multicolored partitions now. So in 1989, Akiyama and Alon showed that if you have D sets, okay, of N marbles each, so each AI contains N marbles, and let's say each particular marble has a different color. So all the marbles of the set AI look alike, all the marbles of the set A2 are alike but different from A1 and so on. Okay, and they are placed in general position in RD, then all the marbles, that is all collectively, all these marbles can be partitioned into a rainbow D tuple. So you can have D tuples such that each element of this tuple comes from this, and each such entry is going to be non-zero. Furthermore, each of these D tuple is going to form a convex hull, which is going to be disjoint from the another convex hull formed from another D tuple. So if you have two D tuples, which means two tuples of D elements, first element coming from A1, ith element coming from AI, just like that, you have another D tuple with the same property, then the convex hull created by the first D tuple is disjoint from the convex hull created by the second D tuple. Okay, so you can always partition all the collective marbles of the set union AI into this rainbow D tuples with this property. How do we do this? Is we apply induction on what? The number of marbles. If N is odd, which means if each of the set AI has odd meaning marbles, then you can apply the ham sandwich theorem to get that there is a hyperplane H which is going to bisect each of the AI, and it is going to contain exactly one marble of each color. So you are going to have a hyperplane like this, let's say, okay, and on this side you are going to have half the elements of each of AI, on the other side you're going to have half the elements of each of the AIs, and on this hyperplane H one marble of each color, that means one marble each from every AI is present. So this itself is a D tuple, and these ones are now sets with lesser number of elements than N. So induction applies. And if N is even, then you provoke the general position version by which you can say that each bisecting plane is you have a hyperplane which is going to bisect each of these AIs, and it avoids all of the AIs, which means it is partitioning the entire AIs into exactly half, right? So that is quite simple. Now a real life example for this, or rather application, is that let's say that there are two thieves which have stolen a queen's necklace. And this necklace has many precious stones, and they are embedded also into a precious metal. So, but they do not know how to divide it among themselves, but both of them want exactly half of it. So if let's say all the stones were of all the precious stones of different kinds were even in number, then what can be done is they would want to cut the entire necklace into as many lesser number of pieces as possible, such that each of them gets equal number of pieces from the queen's necklace. Each should get equal number of precious stones of each kind. Okay, so if let's say I have assumed that there is even number of precious stone of each kind, then clearly you can cut D many times to get the, I mean, D cuts looks necessary. Why? You take the entire necklace and you assume, you just count the first type of precious gem starting from 1 up to N and make the cut at the position when N plus, N by 2 many gems have been achieved, right? And once you have done that, after this, the second cut would occur when the second gem is considered, second type of gem, and wherever the half of those many are attained, you cut at that location, and so on. So this way, for D many gems, D cuts looks necessary. What necklace theorem tells us is that this is the worst possible. So what you can really do is that, assuming that the necklace has open ends, okay, so that the precious metal is also a precious metal in which they are embedded, that is also divided equally. Every open necklace with D kinds of stones can be divided between two thieves using no more than D cuts. Yeah. And to show this, it's pretty easy. Place the entire necklace in RD along with the moment curve. Just recall, the moment curve in RD is the curve given by T, T square, and so on up to T raised to D. This is the moment curve in RD. So if you have placed the necklace in RD along the moment curve and you enumerate the stones of the necklace with assuming there are N stones and define AI to be gamma K such that Kth stone is of the Ith type. Okay. So this is of the Ith type. This way you define your set AIs. So then all the stones of AIs are same, right? They are of the Ith kind. And now we can apply the Ham-Sandwich theorem, the discrete version for general position, and the result will follow that there is a hyperplane which is going to bisect all of these AIs into exactly half, avoiding all of these AIs at the same time. So the Ham-Sandwich theorem discrete version gives you the necklace theorem. Another proof of necklace theorem can be obtained, and that follows from the Hobby-Rice theorem. This Hobby-Rice theorem is about the probability measure. So what it says is, if you have probability measures on the closed interval 0, 1, continuous probability measures, by that what we mean is that the integral function 0 to x d mu I is continuous in x for each of these mu I's. That is when you call these probability measures as continuous probability measures on this set. Okay. Then if you have these continuous probability measures, then there is a partition of 0, 1 into d plus 1 intervals a0 to ad and signs epsilon 0 to epsilon d, signs of course plus or minus 1, such that the summation of these mu i's on the aj's along with their signs on aj's is zero. Okay, so I am leaving that as an exercise to prove the necklace theorem using the Hobby-Rice theorem. Now, once this is done, we come to the next topic, which is the Kinneser's conjecture and its proof. I am not going to give the Lovaas's original proof in this one, but similar idea I'm going to use. So first of all, we'll understand what a Kinneser's graph is. So start with two positive integers n and k such that k is less than or equal to n. A Kinneser's graph is defined as a graph whose vertex set is the collection of all k subsets of n. Remember, this n is the set 1, 2 up to n. So all the k subsets of this n set are the vertex set of this particular graph, and two such k subsets are going to be adjacent, which means they form an edge if they are disjoint. So A and B are two k subsets and they're going to be adjacent if and only if A intersection B is empty. And we denote a Kinzer graph on NK, which means a graph whose vertex set is K subsets of N set by KG subscript N comma K. Now let's just see a few examples of these Kinzer graphs to get familiar with these. KG N1, which means all the one subsets of N. That precisely just gives you all the vertices of KG N1 and more particularly, these are just the one subsets of N, which means these are the numbers 1 up to N. And any two vertices are now going to be adjacent if they are disjoint, which means any two numbers which are different from each other are adjacent. So that is nothing but the complete graph on N vertices, right? So if let's say N is 3, this is how the picture looks like. 1, 2, 3, these are the three vertices of this particular graph. And 1 is connected to 2, 1 is also connected to 3, 2 is also connected to 3, because they are forming disjoint subsets, disjoint one subsets of 3. Okay, for now, leave this, we'll come back to this. If you have KG 2K, K plus 1, which means the second coordinate is more than half the first coordinate. Then, if you have chosen any k plus 1 subset of 2k, remaining elements are k minus 1, right? So you cannot have any two k plus 1 subsets that are disjoint, which means this graph is not going to have any number of edges. So if let's say I choose 2k to be 4, that means k is equal to 2, so k plus 1 is 3, which means all three subsets of a 4 set. So 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 4, 1, 3, 4, 2, 3, 4. These are just the four vertices of this particular graph. And there are no edges. Why? Because there are no two disjoint k plus 1 subsets of 2k. If let's say I have chosen kg 2k k, which means k subsets of 2k. As soon as you pick k elements, the other k elements are absolutely defined, right? So this is a graph with disjoint edges. If you have chosen these k elements, let's say this, whatever is left, 3 and 4 here. So this is what it is going to form an edge with and nothing else. So this is a graph with just a collection of disjoint edges. Okay, every vertex has degree 1. And this is also called a matching. The first interesting example is of Peterson's graph. What it is? So you are taking two element subsets of a five element set. So here I have labeled these vertices. Okay, 1, 3. Okay, so these braces are missing. This is a bracket 3, 4 subset of the set 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And like this, this is what it looks like. You should check that there is no triangle in this graph. Yeah. And the smallest cycle which you can find here is a C5, a 5 cycle. But before all of that, let's just now fix a few notations and then we can proceed slowly towards the Kinzer's conjecture. If I denote the set N by the letter N, NK to be the K subsets of this N. And if I am going to define from this vertex set, it's in it, essentially the vertex set of the Kinzer's graph KG NK, right? This two M such that K1 and K2 should have same images if they are disjoint from each other. Which means if K1 and K2 were forming an edge, their values should be different. And this is something which will be clear from this part. So recall that chromatic number of a graph is the least number n such that you have a graph map F from G to Kn. Okay, where Kn denotes the complete graph on n vertices. G is the graph which is in picture. Simple graph just means that given two vertices, there is at most one edge between them. And no vertex is a looped vertex, which means no vertex is adjacent to itself. On such a graph, the chromatic number is defined to be a graph map which sends vertices of G to vertices of Kn such that an edge of G should go to an edge of Kn. Okay. Now in Kn, we have already seen, recall from this example, Kn is something where two vertices are adjacent only if they are distinct, right? And now if you see this function f, which was defined from k subsets of n, it was defined in a way that whenever k1 and k2 are going to form an edge, which means they are disjoint from each other, they should go to distinct values, right? So this is going to ask for a graph map where m is some large enough, m is the complete graph with some large enough n. Okay, so cardinality you can choose to be this and define m of kn to be the minimum such number. So this m of kn, so clearly this is going to give you a coloring of the graph, whereas mkn is going to give the chromatic number of this graph, chromatic number of the kg nk, right? F is going to define a proper coloring. Proper coloring means the edges, the vertices of an edges of an edge should go to distinct colors. Okay, no two adjacent vertices should go to the same color. That is a proper coloring. So aim is to find the mkn, which is the least such number, which is also defined as the least number here, which is the chromatic number. Okay, now once we know the chromatic number, let's go back in these examples and check. If you have n vertices where any two distinct vertices are adjacent, what is the least number of colors that is needed to color this graph? In this, it is clear that you need three colors. One color for this, now this is adjacent to this, so this needs to have a different color, let's say color two. And then the third one is adjacent to this as well as this. So this is going to need the third color. So you need three colors. Just like that, if you had a fourth vertex, that fourth vertex we know is going to be adjacent to this, this, and this. So that fourth vertex is going to need four colors and so on. So the chromatic number of kgn1, which is also the complete graph on n vertices, has chromatic number n. Now a graph which does not have any edges at all needs just one color. You can take that color and color all the vertices with that same color. If you have a graph which has just the disjoint edges, how many colors would you need? If let's say I've given color one to this vertex certainly needs a different color. So let's say color two is given to this. Now for this, can I use color one? Of course, I can use color one on this. Can I use color one on this? No. Can I use color 2 on this? Certainly, yes. So color 1 here, color 2 here, color 1 here, color 2 here, similarly color 1 here, color 2 here, or any of the combination of these two, which means an edge requires just two colors. So this entire graph, which is a disjoint collection of edges, requires just two colors. So the chromatic number of kg 2kk, this is a typo, 2kk is 2. Okay. Now, this particular graph, please check for yourself, there is no triangle. If it was a triangle, we know that you need three colors minimum, right? And this graph, even though this does not have any triangle, the least number of colors that is required to color this graph is three. So chromatic number of Peterson's graph, this graph is called Peterson's graph. Chromatic number of this graph is three. Now we come down to defining Kinaeser graph in a general setup, and then we will move to the conjecture and its proof. So if X is a finite set and F is a set system, which is a subset of 2 raised to X, then the Kinaeser graph of F. Now see, we are defining Kinaeser graph for a particular set system. Kinaeser graph of F, denoted as KG, bracket F, has a vertex as F, and any two elements are adjacent if and only if they are disjoint. So it is in some sense a generalized version of what we saw as KG and K. So in this particular notation, our KG and K looks like KG of the K subsets of this. Okay. So you choose the set system to be this particular set system. And KGF would have been written as F, comma, this, where this denotes the vertex set and the second coordinate denotes the edge set. Edge set, you see very clearly F1, F2 being two elements. Okay, these are not the calligraphic F, normal F. F1, F2 in this such that they are disjoint from each other. Now comes the Kinesiuk's conjecture. So what it says is that if you take KG and K, then this graph has chromatic number exactly N minus 2K plus 2. Whenever N is greater than or equal to 2K minus 1. 2K minus 1 is anyway needed, right? Because otherwise you have less number of, you don't get disjoint sets. Okay? So you need as these many number of elements from which you can choose your K sets. And now, we see this by showing it in two steps. We say that the chromatic number cannot be greater than this number, and then we say that chromatic number is at least this much. This will give the equality, right? So to show that the chromatic number cannot exceed this number, let's start with dividing the vertex set of this graph into some particular subsets. How are these subsets chosen? So let Ci to be that subset of the vertex set which contains the element I. So Ci is the collection of all those K subsets that contain element I. This you do till N minus 2K plus 1. Okay. So each of those elements, So any element you choose in Ci, any two elements, are they going to be adjacent to each other? No. Why? Because both of those elements will contain the element I. And two elements in the graph can be adjacent if and only if the corresponding subsets are disjoint from each other. Yeah. So in other words, you can say that the set Ci is independent. So just to record again, a subset S of a vertex set is independent if any two elements of this set, they are not adjacent to each other. Okay. So since no two elements of Ci are adjacent to each other, the set Ci is independent. And also, if you remember the definition of the chromatic number, we know that all the elements of an independent set can be given one particular color because there is no edge, and hence it is going to give a proper color. However, if you look at the set N minus 2K plus 2, N minus 2K plus 3, and so on up till N, then this has exactly N minus the first point plus 1, so 2K minus 1 many elements, right? So the these I have formed till N minus 2K plus 1. For I till N minus 2K plus 1. I equal to 1 till N minus 2K plus 1. Now the last one particular set which I am looking at. So see, Ci, none of the Ci's which is previously considered contains this element, any of these elements. Okay, or if you want to see it even more specifically, choose Ci to be those elements whose least element is I, right? So N minus 2K plus 2 is not present or rather, let me just rephrase it. So this has 2k minus 1 many elements, and if you choose any k subset of this, then any two k subsets of this particular set are going to intersect, right? Therefore, whatever is left from these, it cannot be independent. But if you take the disjoint union of these, all of these sets, and take its you take its complement in the vertex set, define it to be C prime, this is an independent set. Why? Because any of its K element subset has to intersect here. So I have partitioned my entire V vertex set of KG and K into the disjoint union of these CIs from n minus 2k plus up till n minus 2k plus 1 and this last piece. And each of these elements is a independent set. And how many are there? N minus 2k plus 1 plus 1 more. So n minus 2k plus 2 many independent sets. They collectively form the entire vertex set. And since any independent set can be given one single color, you can give one color to each of these CIs. And so that way you would have consumed n minus 2k plus 1 many colors, and you give the n minus 2k plus 2th color to C prime. And this way you can color the vertex set of KG and K by at most n minus 2k plus 2 many colors. Therefore, the chromatic number of KG and K cannot be more than n minus 2k plus 2. Now, the other side, which is given by Green recently, this is the proof we are going to use for the reverse inequality that the chromatic number is at least n minus 2k plus 2. Okay, for this, let D to be the number n minus 2k plus 1. Okay, 1 less than the cardinality of the vertex set of this graph, and x is in SD is an n point set such that no hyperplane through the center of this sphere contains more than d points of x. This you can always do. Why? Recall the general version of ham sandwich. Okay, through that you can always find a hyperplane. You can always put these into a general position such that no hyperplane through the center of SD contains more than d points of x. Okay. Now, if you suppose the chromatic number to be less than equal to d, we are starting with a contradiction. What does it say? We wanted to prove that this is greater than equal to n minus 2k plus 2, which is actually d plus 1. To contrary, assume that this is strictly less than d plus 1, which is same as less than equal to d. So if you assume that the chromatic number is at least less than equal to d, at most d, take one such d coloring of this graph, and we define the sets a1 up to ad of SD as this. So some point x is going to be in AI if okay, this partition word is wrong. I wanted to write define them as. So any point x in AI is there if you have a k subset of color I contained in the open hemisphere HX centered at X. So if you have taken any point of SD, okay, so you can look at the hemisphere defined with X as the center. And if that hemisphere contains a K subset of color I, you put that element X in AI. if it contains a f of color, let's say some aj, you put that point in aj, and so on. Okay, so this way you define your a1 up to ad, since we have assumed that it needs d colors, and ad plus 1 to be the complement of this particular union in SD. Clearly, all A1 up to AD are open. They are unions of these hemispheres. And AD plus 1 being the complement of a union of finitely many open sets is closed. So AD plus 1 is closed. So now you are having SD being covered by some open sets and some closed sets. Therefore, by a generalization of LSC and LSO, the problem 4 which I had given in the first assignment, there is an I in D plus 1 such that AI intersection, rather the opposite of AI is non-empty, which is equivalent to saying that there is an I such that in the D plus 1 and a point X in the SD such that X and minus X both are in the same AI. So some AI contains a pair of antipodal points, right? Now, if I happens to be less than equal to D, which means you have hit upon, so this particular I, which is into existence by the Borsuk-Ulam theorem, this is one of these ADs. That means this and this particular X, which is in this AI, implies that X is an AI as well as minus X is an AI, which means you have some F which is of color I is contained in the hemisphere HX, and there is some F of color I which is contained in the hemisphere H of minus X. So this means there is a disjoint couple of color I. Why disjoint? Because they are getting the same color. That means they have to be disjoint. Otherwise, they will form an edge. So you have disjoint k tuples, okay, of the same color, but they are contained, one is in H of X and the other one is H of minus X, but that is not possible. Whereas if I happen to be this last one, which you have defined here, then H of X and H of minus X both contain, since both of them contain at most k minus 1 points of X, this implies that the complement of these spaces in SD contains at least these many points, the D plus 1 many points. But this is a contradiction. Why? Because we started with the arrangement so that no hyperplane through the center of SD contains more than D points of X. And why the center? Because if you have taken any particular point and you take its hyper plane, then this union contains everything but the equator. So then its complement in SD is an equator. Therefore, that is a hyperplane which is going through the center of SD, and this is going to contain D plus 1 points of X, which is again a contradiction. So this I does not exist, and hence all this business falls down because the chromatic number of kg and k is bigger than d. So it is at least d plus 1, or chromatic number of kg and k is n minus 2k plus 2. With this, the Kinesis conjecture has been proved. You should look up the proof given by Lovash, which was the first proof for this particular result. They find something called a Borsuk graph, and they define a very beautiful simplicial complex related with the neighborhood complex, which one of you have talked about, and it's a nice result, not very hard to follow. So look that up. Okay, with this, I will close this. In the next lecture, we'll see two more applications of the Borsuk-Ulam theorem, and then we'll switch to the next topic. Thank you.